Do you remember Playhouse Disney? Playhouse Disney. If you were born in the late 90s or early 2000s, chances are very likely you remember watching this program and block as a kid. During this time, other channels had their own educational block for children. PBS had their PBS Kids, Nickelodeon had their Nick Jr., Cartoon Network, well...
They make funny noises too. Tickle You, coming in August to Cartoon Network.
While it's arguable Nickelodeon ruled the 90s with their iconic children's programming, Nick Jr. sort of fell off during the early 2000s. Around this time, many of their older shows had ended, and their flagship show had lost their host. Around this time, Playhouse Disney had just acquired the Wiggles in their lineup. I'd argue this pre-Mickey Mouse Clubhouse era was the peak of Playhouse Disney, a thriving era defined by diverse content, from Koala Brothers to JoJo Circuses. When 90s nostalgia blew up several years back, tons of kids' shows sort of relapsed in relevancy. I've yet to see any of these shows receive as much attention, and I feel it's justified to dedicate a video to them. These shows were as influential to me as, say, Sesame Street or Blue's Clues was. Today, we're going to be looking back at the forgotten era, the heyday of Playhouse Disney.
Are you with me?
Every morning inside Playhouse Disney on Disney Channel,
we're going on a trip.
I'm sort of starting off this video with the most popular of these shows. It's clear Little Einsteins was the exception to many of these shows that fell by the wayside. Its popularity was thriving way into 2014 with its theme song remix that went viral. The show itself ran for over 4 years, and starred a group of highly intelligent children. There was Leo, the one kid whose name I could actually remember the group, June, the forgettable one, Quincy, the musical one, and Annie, the one who switched from blue jeans to pink jeans over the first to second season. For some reason, this really bothered me as a kid, I don't know why. The series centered around the gang flying around in Rocket, one of the coolest characters on the show. When these guys were ready to take off, it was an event. They'd always make a huge deal about it, and used a fairly innovative technique to get kids to participate in the launch.
We're going to need a lot of power to blast off. Pat, pat, pat.
Unlike Dora, which had you screaming at the top of your lungs to get her attention.
Come on, Dora! You're the one with the map! Don't ask me!
The interaction between the characters and the viewer was much better through this method. There'd always be an enormous sense of satisfaction knowing you helped Rocket take off. The series focused mainly around classical music. I remember every episode had the characters wrap up the segment by introducing some obscure musical piece. One you'd very likely forget if it wasn't Beethoven's. I always remembered the Beethoven ones because of this show. It's sort of derivative of the Dora formula, but I'd personally classify this show as Dora, but with some actual effort. Its animation, writing, and characters, they're vastly superior. One thing that always sort of weirded me out was this character, Big Jet. Big Jet was supposed to be the foil to Rocket. He'd always fly around trying to ruin the Einsteins' fun. What weirded me out was that we never saw his pilot. I get it, it's a sentient jet. They could fly on their own without humans. But Rocket always seemed to need assistance to take off for long stretches of time. So I always just assumed there was some grown man chasing these little kids around in Big Jet. Perhaps the Einsteins were a failed government experiment of intelligence surplus. And Big Jet's just trying to chase them down after they escape from the CIA. When I was a kid, it was clear to me what my favorite show was. JoJo Circus always holds a special place in my heart. Not just the fact that it was claymation, how often do you see those anymore? That's one of my favorite things about the old days at Playhouse. There was so much experimentation with the cartoon's art styles. JoJo starred a little clown named JoJo. We, the audience, explore her daily life in Circus Town with her pet lion, Goliath. The series was rich in creativity, with all sorts of fun supporting characters inhabiting the village. That's the thing, I really respect JoJo. The animation really holds up well, and the world building on the show is great, probably one of the best ensembles I've seen in children's television. The stories were kind of basic, nothing really too exciting, but it was really the characters that were the backbone of the show. I don't think it captures the excitement Einsteins had to offer. JoJo was a bit more grounded, and certainly funnier, too. When JoJo breaks the fourth wall and addresses the audience, it doesn't feel, I guess, as forced as Einsteins. I mean, no show really can break the fourth wall as well as the Steve era Blue's Clues or Chowder, but JoJo definitely had a better connection with its audiences. One thing that's weird is that there were apparently songs in every episode, but I cannot remember a single one to save my life. I guess that's the show's weak spot. After a decade of not watching something, you tend to forget its catchy songs. Still, I remember my favorite episode, the Thanksgiving Day Parade episode. Why was it my favorite? I don't know. I guess because it starred my favorite character, Mrs. Krasplatsky. Something about her. I just always really liked her. She kind of made me excited to go to school for the first time and learn. Not all these shows were perfect. I can tell you that. Playhouse Disney had its fair share of good shows, but trust me, there were the bad ones. Doodle Bops are sort of a knockoff Canadian Wiggles. That's how I always looked at them. Premiering in 2005 and lasting just a little over two pathetic years, the Doodle Bops captivated children of Canada everywhere and annoyed parents of all kinds. Yeah, in retrospect, this show sucks. Imagine a bad Butch Hartman running gag, one that lasts an entire episode of one of his shows. Now imagine that being drawn out in every episode of his series. Hey, children's entertainment likes to repeat itself. It often gives the child a sense of familiarity and comfort. That's not a proven fact, I could be entirely wrong. I know nothing about child development. But what I do know is that Mo really liked to hide from his friends. Like, hide in every episode from his friends. In a segment called,
Where's Jeff?
One thing's for sure about the Doodle Bops is that it really liked its puppets. One of the most memorable to me is this forsaken monster. Mr. Moosehead, for some reason I remember you looking a little bit different. That's nostalgia for you. The rose-tinted glasses are gone. Moose aside, I think the biggest problem with this show is it's just too colorful. Too rambunctious, full of way too much yelling, sound effects, and loud noises. This isn't supposed to stimulate your mind, it's supposed to keep your child quiet for 21 minutes. Also, these guys actually went on tour? Props to them for going through that, they certainly pulled through. Mo was always my favorite as a young kid because, come on, he's this big goofy orange drummer. He was always the silly one in the trio. The band toured briefly after the series was cancelled, but they haven't really done anything since. I don't think they're doing the world an injustice either. It's not craving for a Doodle Bops comeback. Just one of those stupid shows you used to like as a kid that really had no charm at all in retrospect.
Charlie!
Disney really knew how to pace themselves in their lineup. After the energy-fueled Doodle Bops, we had a far more laid-back Charlie and Lola. It's British, what do you expect? Based off the book series of the same name, Charlie and Lola centers around two siblings, as the older, more mature one, Charlie, convinces his stubborn little sister Lola to cave into something she doesn't want to do. He generally uses imagination to sway her opinion, and it always leads to the same result. A novel concept with a cute design. I don't have too much to say about the show because I honestly can't remember a single thing about it. I know for a fact I watched it, but the only thing I remember about this show were the online games that featured the same child voice actors. I still remember those games. They centered around Lola being picky about eating carrots, fish fingers, and peas. I'm just gonna assume most episodes were like those games, but longer. Decent show, pretty harmless I guess, but not too memorable. I'll give it some credit though, it's the first show so far that doesn't rely on audience interaction. Remember those eggs in Toy Stories that ate each other when they got scared? Yeah, apparently those are called troikas. And apparently they're similar to a Russian toy called a
matryoshka
doll. And in 2004, Disney decided it'd be a good idea to air a show based off these toys. Honestly, I never even knew what these guys were supposed to be. I always just thought of them as a mixture of Weebles and 1970s Fisher-Price toys. But I guess not. The series featured these four kids who would go around solving problems with their local heroes. You know, that's a not every superhero wears a cape story. Each episode revolves around a specific issue that requires the assistance of these heroes, to which the audience would learn about their different jobs in the community. I think the show faces a similar problem as Little Einstein does. As in, the main cast is entirely forgettable. What? You have the worried one who wears glasses, the tall one, the blue one, the girl. To be fair, the girl was probably my favorite character out of the main cast. The show would have this recurrent segment where it'd shift art styles whenever she'd propose a ridiculous solution to an existing problem. Sure, you could argue it's filler, but honestly, it's at least more appealing than...
Pull the rope!
Despite its forgettable main cast, there is one character who stood out from the rest of them. I'm of course talking about... the Pizza Guy.
Pizza Guy!
Every time this guy would roll up in an episode, it was an event. He was hands down the coolest character on the show. I don't care what anyone says, Pizza Guy is the top tier hero. Why else is he in the center of the promotional poster? Overall, the show's kinda mixed. It has an original enough art style and premise to get by, but those main characters just don't interest me. Ah yes, Stanley. A classic. Stanley was a series about a little boy who went on adventures through his big book of everything. The book would teleport him and his pets to some wild part of the world, where each episode would focus on a different animal. I have a lot of respect for Stanley. I don't know, the show always had a more laid-back vibe to it, you know? Sort of always had this timeless appeal to its premise. Really, the only dated thing about it would be that the Baha men sing the show's theme.
Who let the dogs out?
I think the show's concept is really creative. For the guy who brought us Doug, Jim Jenkins really went all out when developing these kid shows. When I look back on these older kid shows, I sometimes forget about Stanley. But once I remember about him, it always sort of makes me happy. I can't bring myself to hate this show. It's not in my nature. It's just a really good kid show. Solid animation, interesting premise, likable characters. It's arguably one of the best shows that aired on Playhouse. I just want to mention on the show's Wikipedia page, there's a paragraph listing the episodes in which Stanley's dog wears a swimsuit. So in case you're ever in a jam and need this information, now you know where to find it. Is it a problem that I don't have too much to say about this one? It's a show for toddlers, I get it, it's not meant for any deep analysis. But has it really held up? The premise is fairly original, two koala brothers flying around at the outback helping their friends. It was a rather tame show, just a cast of really likable characters who lived in a common setting. I always liked the show's cast. I don't know if it's the art direction that makes them so appealing, but there was always something just there. Again, props to the creators for using stop motion, criminally underutilized in television animation. But other than that, there's nothing too much I can say about this one. The main characters aren't too memorable. I cannot remember a difference between the Koala Brothers that makes their personality indistinguishable. They're the Mike and Ike of television. Overall, I'd say it's a decent show for kids, but I much preferred the online games when I was little. Again, one of those cases where I think it worked better through different forms of media. But this show was alright too. I don't recall it ever really breaking the fourth wall like JoJo did, so I'll at least give it that. Decent show, just not as great as my nostalgia glasses would fool me into thinking it was. Alright, so remember Bear in the Big Blue House? One of the finest children's shows to air on television, it was one of Playhouse's original shows back in 1997. Unfortunately, the series went on hiatus around the time I was born. The voice actors for Luna, Sherilyn Thigpen, passed away, and the cast and crew were uncertain about the show's
future.
So instead of continuing the show without one of the core voice actors, they simply decided to cancel it, with the last episodes being dumped on the channel in 2006. However, this wouldn't be the last time we'd hear from Bear. In 2005, Disney premiered a spin-off series featuring Bear, without the Big Blue House. Breakfast with Bear, as they called it, starred Bear visiting children, and well, eating breakfast with them. Wasn't the most revolutionary thing out there, I know. All the fun and excitement that made the original series so great sucked out of this thing. I remember this coming on and being bored out of my mind for the 10 minutes it plagued my screen. What's interesting is this thing became lost media. Obviously, Disney didn't see a need to archive such a trivial series, but more than half the alleged episodes remain lost. What sucks is this is probably the only piece of lost media I've ever seen before its disappearance. All my old Playhouse Disney recordings were re-recorded over. we didn't see much of a need to buy new VHS tapes during the 2000s and early 2010s, so we simply just reused tapes when we stopped watching them regularly. While I'm kind of bummed that it probably destroyed some lost media, it's honestly nothing too great. From the few episodes you could find online, it's evident this thing was filler. Simply a cash grab to take up some time. I'll give Noelle McNeil some credit for doing well staying in character while interacting with the kids, but that's about all I'll give this series. Okay, so originally I was going to cover the Wiggles on this video. Arguably the greatest entertainers in children's music, I was lucky enough to grow up during their classic years. However, you already know about the Wiggles. I figure if I was going to do a video on semi-obscure Disney shows, I figure I could save them for another time. So, have you ever heard of Avenue Q?
It sucks to be me.
No, it sucks to be me.
It sucks to be me.
It sucks to be me.
Is there anybody here that doesn't suck to be me?
It sucks to be me.
A very raunchy Broadway comedy featuring puppeteering. Yeah, this show was created by one of the leading actors. Meet John Tartaliaga. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right. A man who had his start as a puppeteer on Sesame Street, his big break came in 2005 when he performed the character Rod, a closeted Republican bank investor on the Broadway hit Avenue Q. The same year, he released this show.
I came to live in this house in the woods, to work on my music on my own. But somehow I feel it's a magical place, and somehow I feel I'm not alone. I was just Johnny till I walked through that door, but I'm not just Johnny anymore. I'm Johnny and the Sprites.
Johnny and the Sprites debuted in October 2005, earned all five of its shorts on one day, according to the Wikipedia article at least. I kind of find that hard to believe, but regardless, these shorts start Johnny, a young composer living in his great uncle's house. Here, he discovers these magical creatures called the Sprites. I only grew up on the shorts. By the time it became a half-hour series, I'd already moved on to far more sophisticated entertainment.
Curious George, starting Labor Day on PBS Kids.
But the original shorts themselves were very charming, a great way to break up the programming. I remember a feeling of calm and warmth surrounding this series. Just the atmosphere, the lights, the night sky, a little tune. It was just a great series looking back. It's no wonder the show was adapted into a full series. I feel this show is often highly forgotten amongst the other children's puppet shows. Do you remember this? I like to hear some love for it.
Way up high in the roly-poly sky is a little round planet of a really nice guy.
Remember when I said Johnny and the Sprites sort of conveyed this level of tranquility towards this audience? Well, Roly Poly Oly obliterates any sense of calm the moment that theme song starts.
He's Roly Poly Oly, he's small and smart and round.
And yet, somehow, this series lasted over 5 years. You could have been born in 1998 and have been raised your entire toddlerhood on this thing. Roly Poly Oly somehow succeeded the lifespan of many of its contemporaries. You could turn on the television, gloom and disappointment over Steve leaving Blue's Clues, Mr. Rogers saying farewell, those sandwich otters getting canned, and yet, Roly Poly Oly will still be there, gazing down on you with his primitive CGIs, mocking your very existence, dedicating your time to his will. Also, he had not one but two movies. Roly Poly Oly, it'll always be inseparable with its animation. Look at this thing, it's the embodiment of 90s computer aesthetics. I personally love the look of this show. As far as I know, this series never really improved its animation. An episode from 1998 is interchangeable with one from 2003. But to be fair, it looks a lot better than most CG shows from that time.
Hi, I'm Tech Officer 2T, and those are my buds, Commander Bebop and Corporal Doo-Wop. Even though we were sent to invade your planet, we just found it too cool to conquer.
And for that, I respect it, you know? It's sort of fitting that we end this retrospective on little kids' shows with one of the earliest examples of CGI in kids' programming. We live in an era where 3D is the norm in animation. One of the reasons I made this video was to highlight the varieties in art styles and techniques these shows would use. Now, 15 years later, I feel like every show looks identical. Their Paw Patrols are interchangeable with whatever kids watch these days. But this show is a testament that CGI can be stylized, effectively too. you can still have a very unique looking show. That doesn't necessarily mean it has to be ugly to be one. I don't think Rolly or his sister or his Bach friend are ugly, but rather I think their designs are able to translate well from 3D to 2D. The designs are simple geometric shapes. The staff knew their limitations and created an aesthetically unique show, one that takes advantage of its simplicity. Now, I'm not saying that the writing of this show is phenomenal. It was just pretty good for a kids' program. It wasn't derivative of fourth wall breaks, and the character interactions are fairly believable. In a world shrouded in creativity, the show kept its core values grounded. I think this is one of the most unique shows that ever aired on television. There will never be a show quite like this one, and while it had its flaws, I think it's a great capture of its era. An era willing to experiment with all sorts of creative ideas, just to see what'll hit the floor. It was fun looking back on some of my favorite childhood shows. It gave me a chance to reconnect with these characters and settings. I got to look at them from a much older perspective. Looking at these opened my eyes to the importance of children's entertainment. They help mold who you are at a very young and impressionable age. And I feel a lot of these shows really hold up well in that regard. I'm glad to have given them the recognition they deserve.